Hi everybody, my name is Dimitris and today I'm going to talk about how we can reason about unsound static analysis in a rigorous way. So usually in static analysis research, you know, in academia, we always start with soundness. Okay, so, you know, let's say we want to analyze a lambda calculus based language, you know, we will define our abstract semantics, we will prove soundness. And only after we have soundness do we try to improve other aspects of the analysis, such as, you know, trying to make it precise or try to make it scalable. However, in industry, the situation is quite different. There, the first concern that we need to satisfy is that the analysis must be practical. It must be useful in some way. And often, in order to achieve that, we need to sacrifice soundness. And there can be many reasons for that, depending on the use case. For example, imagine you are writing a bug-finding tool, and the language you're analyzing is a complex real-world language. Then maybe if you do a sound analysis, you end up with a very high number of false positives, and then the users won't be able to actually dig through all the warnings to find the true errors. So you end up making the tool unsound in order to increase precision. Or maybe, you know, if you were going to analyze the language in a sound way, the algorithm would be really slow. But if you use a faster algorithm that is unsound, then you can scale your analysis to large programs with, let's say, hundreds of thousands or millions of lines of code. Or maybe the technique to achieve soundness in that case may be very complex, you know, maybe you don't even understand it very well. However, there can be a simple algorithm that is correct most of the time and results in a much more maintainable implementation. So you end up going with a simpler approach. So, you know, there are all these reasons. And basically, as a result, kind of soundness is unsoundness is everywhere. And let's see a few prominent examples. There's a tool called ProGuard, which is a tool that optimizes Java code. And ProGuard detects unused classes and removes them. However, it cannot detect the usage through reflection. So if you use a class reflectively and in no other way, ProGuard is going to remove it. That's why ProGuard lets programmers actually declare explicitly which classes must be kept because of reflection. Another example is Microsoft's type checker called TypeScript. It's a JavaScript type checker. And TypeScript's type system is not sound. However, there are IDEs that perform automated refactorings and are powered by TypeScript. So if these IDEs have unsound type information, they may rewrite the program and break it. And last, it is the tool that I'm working on at Google called Closure Compiler. And Closure Compiler is a JavaScript type checker like TypeScript, but is also an optimizer. And our type system is unsound. But we do have optimization passes that use type information. So if the type information is incorrect, these passes may break the code. And it's worth noting here that, you know, when I talk to my academic friends about, you know, unsound analysis, an unsound bug-finding tool is kind of more common, but it sounds very strange to people that someone can use an unsound analysis for optimization because, you know, folklore says that if you are optimizing, you need the analysis to be sound. However, we have used an unsound analysis successfully for many years to optimize code. Okay, let's spend a second to talk about JavaScript type systems in particular, because I'm going to use JavaScript type checking as the canonical example of an unsound analysis for the rest of this talk, just because it's the area that I'm most familiar with. So JavaScript itself does not have a type system, but there have been type systems that are added as extensions. And the most highly used of those are Clojure compiler from Google, TypeScript from Microsoft, and Flow from Facebook. And all of these type systems are unsound. And there's a good reason that all of us chose unsoundness. And it's because JavaScript is a very dynamic language. And it has features like, you know, computed property accesses or objects whose size grows and shrinks at runtime, or inheritance hierarchy that can change at runtime, and so on. So in order to have any hope of analyzing the language statically, we make some compromises. Okay, I'm not going to go into more details about JavaScript, but I have included here a link to a talk I gave a few months ago if you want to learn more. Okay, so given that unsound analyses are ubiquitous, if we need to deal with an unsound analysis, how can we evaluate it? How can we decide whether it's good or not? Traditionally, the way people do that is based on user feedback. So the analysis implementer will ask users, you know, does the analysis find the bugs you expect it to find? Does it have a lot of false positives and so on? So it's basically an ongoing dialogue between the maintainers and the users, and the analysis gets tweaked and gradually improves over time. And this process works well in practice, but the main drawback is that there aren't really any formal guarantees. So if you want to compare two analyses that are supposedly solving the same problem, it is very subjective. The comparison would be really subjective. And also, having no formal guarantees has meant historically that unsound analyses are kind of a second-class citizen in the research literature, okay? They have been neglected. So, I'm definitely not arguing to drop the empirical evaluation. It is very useful. But what if, on top of that, we also had a way to evaluate unsound analysis more rigorously? And if we had such a method, there are many potential benefits. One of them is that we might be able to talk about degrees of soundness, you know, how much... how unsound an analysis is, you know, is it blatantly unsound or is it correct most of the time in practice, and so on. Another potential benefit is that we would be able to compare different analyses in a systematic way, in a quantitative way. And last, we would kind of be able to give people a kind of a tool, a framework to reason about unsound analyses. And that might result in more interest in research on unsound analysis and may result in novel unsound analysis techniques. So how would we go about doing that? So the main intuition is that in practice, soundness is not a binary property. It's not that an analysis is either sound or not sound. It's a continuum, okay? And for example, for JavaScript type checkers, we can go from the absolutely unsound type checker that always runs in constant time and says that a program has no type errors to like a perfect analysis. There is a very large spectrum in between, and each analysis has its own kind of trade-offs in terms of scalability, precision, and so on. So we would like to be able to formalize this intuition that, you know, there is kind of this whole spectrum of analysis and kind of soundness, right? And the way that I propose to do that is that we can borrow an idea from machine learning. So consider a machine learning classifier that decides whether an email message is spam or not. Such a classifier can err in two ways. It can either say that a not spam email is spam, or it can say that a spam email is not spam. However, the fact that the classifier can have both false positives and false negatives does not make it useless. On the contrary, it can be a really useful tool. So I think this is the viewpoint that we should adopt when evaluating unsound analysis. And specifically, it would be good if we can use measures like precision and recall to evaluate static analysis. And essentially, that would be a statistical view of program analysis instead of a logical view. Let's talk briefly about precision and recall for those who may have not heard of these measures. So if we have, let's say, a large data set of emails and humans have given us ground truth information, and for each email, humans have decided whether it's a spam email or not. So we know the true answer. Then we can run a machine learning system on each email. And precision is basically of all the emails that our machine learning system classifies as spam, how many truly are spam? So high precision basically means a small number of false positives. And then recall is of all the emails in the data set that are spam, how many did we detect? Did we miss a lot of spam email? So recall is a measure of false negatives. So high recall means a few false negatives. And you see that if we adopt this mindset, then we immediately have a way to actually talk about degrees of soundness. And we can say things like an analysis is more sound than another analysis. And that tool is just recall, okay? More recall means fewer false negatives, so it means more soundness. Okay, so I'm going to propose kind of two ways that we can use these ideas to kind of evaluate static analysis. So one possible way to go about it is that we could create a data set with labeled data to evaluate static analysis, right? And it could be something like ImageNet. So ImageNet is a public data set that is used to evaluate object recognition, image recognition systems. And ImageNet contains millions of images, and the objects in these images have been categorized into thousands of categories. Things like, you know, cat, dog, person, table, and so forth. So we could have similar data sets to evaluate static analysis, right? So for example, if we wanted to evaluate JavaScript type checkers, so one thing we could do is that, for example, in Clojure compiler, we have, let's say, about 2,400 unit tests for our type checker. And all the warnings that we emit can be categorized into about 100 diagnostic types. For example, we can have the invalid argument type, meaning that you're passing an argument of the wrong type to a function, or we have wrong argument count, meaning that you're calling a function with too few or too many arguments, and a missing property, meaning that you are accessing a property that doesn't exist on an object, and so forth. So one thing we could do is we could fix the number of diagnostic types, and all type checkers could use the same diagnostics for their warnings. And then we can use test suites in order to create at least the first version of a labeled data set. Okay. And then, you know, of course, we would improve the data set over time. So if we had such a data set, then if we want to evaluate a type checker, we would run it on each program in the data set. And then if we find a warning that was expected in the ground truth, that's a true positive. If we find a warning that was not expected, that's a false positive. If we miss a warning that was expected, that's a false negative. So that's a place where we are unsound. And if we correctly find no warnings, that's a true negative. And then we can use true positives and false positives and so on to kind of score the type checker on one program, and then from there also score it on the whole data set. And I'm not actually going to propose a way to do that. It's a little bit tricky. So some of the issues are that a program in that data set can have more than one warning, right? And some of the warnings in the same program may even be of the same diagnostic type. So this means that an analysis may find, you know, a true positive and a false positive for the same program. So we need to decide how to score it overall for the program. And on top of that, we also need to care about where the warnings appear in the source. Going back to the ImageNet example, they run into the same issues, and they have this object localization competition where machine learning tools are trying to locate objects in images. And for each image in the dataset, they have defined a formula that calculates the error for each image. And the error ranges from 0 to 1. And it depends on the categories of objects detected and also the overlap of the bounding boxes of the detected objects and the ground truth objects. For example, you know, if the tool says that there's a cat, let's say in the top left corner, but it is actually in the bottom right corner, then there is no overlap, and you know, that's just wrong. And then they calculate the average error for the whole data set to score the tool, and then the tool that has the minimum average error wins the competition. So we could somehow devise a similar formula to score our analysis on our data sets. So if we had such a data set to evaluate static analysis, what are some of the benefits? Well, the first obvious one is that we now have a quantitative way to compare different analyses, okay, and decide which one is better. And then on top of that, we are reasoning about analysis only care about how they perform, not what the algorithm is. And this is important because if we are analyzing, let's say, complicated real-world languages such as JavaScript, and we wanted to reason about our analysis by actually formalizing the analysis algorithm itself, that would have been much more difficult, okay? Because the language and the algorithm itself may have hundreds of corner cases. But by just focusing on evaluating the result, that makes it more manageable. Another benefit is that with this kind of evaluation, soundness is no longer special. It is just one of the possible designs that we can choose, right? Because soundness basically just means perfect recall. And for some analysis problems, to achieve perfect recall, maybe we would have to sacrifice precision so much that it would be very, very low and not acceptable, right? And I claim that JavaScript type checking is one of those problems. So we would want in this framework to have a balance between precision and recall, not focusing only on one of the two. All right. Now, let's say for whatever reason that, you know, the analysis we're interested in evaluating, we don't have access to labeled data, okay? Maybe this is because it would be too expensive to create a data set or too time consuming. Or maybe we are working with an experimental language, you know, a research project, where there just aren't enough programs to create a data set. One thing we can do in this case is we can use an instrumented interpreter for the language as the source of truth, since we don't have labeled data. So basically, we would run a program with the interpreter. We would run a program. We would run the analysis on a program, and we would compare the results and see how well the analysis did. So in order to do that, going back to JavaScript type checking again, we would have to define an abstraction function. So we would map every concrete value to an abstract value. And in this case, let's say that the abstract values are sets of types. And then we would run the program with the interpreter, and we would collect all values that flow through each program point. And then we would abstract these values. So for each program point, we would have an abstract value that is computed from the interpreter, actually. And then we would run the analysis on the same program, and we would compute a different abstract value for the same program point. And so if these two sets are equal, this means that the analysis computed the correct result. If the set from the interpreter is a subset of the set from the analysis, it means that the analysis overapproximated, so we have a false positive for that program point. If the set from the interpreter is a superset of the set from the analysis, it means that the analysis underapproximated, so we have unsoundness in that case. And last, if the two sets are not equal but are also not in the subset relation, it means that the analysis result is wrong, but it is neither an overapproximation nor an underapproximation. And by doing that, we would basically be able to kind of find the percentage of code in the program that the analysis analyzed correctly, and the percentage of false positives and false negatives, and kind of get a score for the whole program. And then, how would we go from a single program to kind of evaluating the analysis on the whole language? There, we kind of have two options. One is that if we're dealing with a real-world language and we have access to kind of a large code base, we can repeat this exercise basically on all the programs in the code base. So run them through the interpreter and the analysis and compare. Or if we don't have that, then we can follow a Monte Carlo approach and basically generate a bunch of random programs and do the comparison on those randomly generated programs. And then a caveat of this approach, a thing to remember, is that that interpreters, will execute only live code. So we need to decide what to do with incomplete programs or programs with dead code. So, for example, if we have kind of a library, so it has a bunch of functions that are never called, how can we analyze them? Do we need to synthesize some calls to its library functions? Or if we have code with inputs, do we need to synthesize some inputs to actually start executing the code? So just something that we need to take care of in this approach. Okay, so these are kind of the two ways that we can kind of start using machine learning ideas to evaluate static analysis. And now we're just about ready to conclude, so let's see some kind of overall important points. So the first thing I want to highlight is that in this talk we just discussed about evaluating static analysis. But we did not say anything about how to design unsound analysis, okay? So I just want to note that all the familiar techniques that we know from the design of sound analysis just transfer over to unsound analysis. So that's good. And then the only difference is that after we have designed our analysis, how do we evaluate it? That's the only difference here. And another point I want to clarify is that I'm not saying that unsound analyses are good for everything, and I'm not proposing to expand the uses of unsound analysis, only to evaluate unsound analysis more rigorously. In particular, let's say, for example, that you want an analysis a security analysis that looks at untrusted JavaScript code and needs to decide whether the code introduces vulnerabilities. Since this code may have been written by a malicious entity, it is actually a bad idea to use the existing type checkers to analyze it, because these type checkers are usually correct when an everyday programmer writes code and does not explicitly try to fool the type checker. But it is still very, very easy to explicitly write programs that kind of go around these type checkers. So, for security analysis of untrusted code, soundness is still good in that case, right? Another thing to highlight is that I'm proposing to kind of evaluate analysis based on machine learning ideas, but an important difference is that machine learning algorithms actually train on the data. And so their result kind of changes depending on the quality of the data they train on. Whereas for static analysis, we typically, just write a fixed algorithm, and then it doesn't really matter what programs we run the analysis on. Its results wouldn't change based on that. And maybe someone could actually end up devising some static analysis that do train on data. So, just something to keep in mind that it's a possibility. Okay, so to summarize, there are kind of two things that I would like you to take away from this talk if you forget everything else. The first is that I'm kind of proposing a shift in perspective from viewing soundness as a binary property to viewing it as a continuum, okay? And there is a wide range of unsound analysis. And in that continuum, soundness is not special, it's just another design point, okay? And if we adopt this viewpoint, we can actually devise measures that account both for false positives and also for false negatives. And by doing that, then we gain the ability to reason about unsound analysis in a rigorous way and not in an ad hoc way. That's all. Thank you very much.